I've always loved fashion, and I was that kid who used to watch my mum get ready and just think, wow, you look amazing. I'd always dreamed of designing a collection. It was always my passion.
When I first met her, she has that spark.
You know, she's a perfectionist in terms of detail.
When I did my first presentation, it really meant something.
We were just stunned, to be honest. It was just not at all what we were expecting.
I was a Spice Girl, married to a footballer. I was trying to do something that no one had really done before.
I think she's proven herself to have a really successful fashion brand. I don't think there's anybody that would doubt that.
We have actually now created, you know, something that is meaningful and that people are paying attention to across the globe.
Things are actually happening very, very quickly. And I think what's quite typical of her is that she sets the benchmark very high.
Most evenings I'm curled up in front of Skype. I travel a lot, my team travel a lot, but I wouldn't have it any other way.
I've always been a hard worker, you know, even when I was at school as a kid, you know, I've always had to work hard for everything.
Once you know the story behind anything, it's more compelling, you can connect with it. Maybe that's what we're doing. My specific recollection was just, it was just a simple fact of, you know, Victoria was getting a bit frustrated that she couldn't get more out of the development process working with a licensed partner.
When I was in LA, you know, I used to have Skype calls with my team. I'm very much a visual person, so it's great for me to actually be able to see the people that I'm talking to.
My strength of being a photographer is to letting the other person live. You know, I respond or I need the input of the subject, you know, and I let them be. She is really with the Spice Girls, and she was a product. And I thought, you know, the products sell, right? So she sells the, for me, like, you know, like perfumes and handbags and shoes, these are kind of products which shifts these fashion companies, you know, not so much the clothes itself. And that's why we had this idea to build this oversized carrier bag where you buy the clothes and put her in it. I think it shocked a lot of people when the pictures came out. I mean, first of all, how powerful the pictures were in itself, and the idea of what an advertising photograph, a fashion advertising photograph, can be in the first place. And so they worked on many, many levels, you know. And it helped Mark, it helped me, and it helped her. It was an all-through winner, you know. And I had so many people telling me that it changed their idea of what Victoria Beckham is. You know, I think I had a massive influence in that.
Being able to put somebody on the cover and have that mean something is one of the great privileges of editing Vogue, because it's probably the magazine that counts the most in that way. So, I mean, sometimes that can backfire, and when people are critical of it, I mean, people feel it's a bit like Marks and Spencer's. People feel like they own the cover of Vogue. So when they don't like who you've put on the cover, you hear about it. But it is, you know, it's a kind of wonderful sort of thing to have, and it's quite powerful endorsement of people. Ooh, it's all in the midst of time, the process of putting Victoria on the cover. Now, it seems like she's been a kind of fashion designer forever to me, but the first time she was on the cover, I'd heard that she was going to make a very small number of dresses, I think it was, and I was approached by her people to discuss it, and I was interested in her as somebody who'd who become a very high profile celebrity, who had managed to have a kind of family life and a famous husband and all of that. So that was part of the package that intrigued me, because at that point I had no idea whether her clothes were going to be any good or not. But once I met her to talk to her about what she was doing before, because I interviewed her for the first cover story, but we had lunch before that, and I came away, you know, very impressed by Victoria's determination and her ability to pick things up. I mean, she just picks up things really quickly. She's like a kind of magpie.
Victoria was making a small and focused dress collection, and she was making that collection in London, you know, which is not the most cost-effective way of doing it. You know, we could have made it somewhere else. But that gave her the creative freedom to produce a collection that really was well made and looked beautiful, and really, I think that was the main reason why people left their inhibitions pretty quickly when it came to accepting that collection amongst the other sort of luxury brands, because of the way it was executed, and that was, we would hear that often, that, you know, these are really beautifully made dresses. There's a lot of corsetry in the beginning, you know, they are, you know, sort of, They're items that you can keep in your wardrobe for generations.
The first time any designer puts their name on that team sheet for a fashion week is just a huge moment. It's such a big challenge to create a collection and then to put yourself up against the kind of names you're going to be up against. If you're in New York, there's your name and there's Ralph Lauren. If you're in Paris, there's you and there's Givenchy. These are really serious events, and the standard is very, very high. And people are there, they're very, very businesslike, very quick to judge you, and you don't get a second chance. The nature of the fashion industry is that people will come and they will look, and if they think you're talented, they'll come and look again. But if they think there's nothing there, you're over. You can be out so quickly. So to present yourself that first time when you just want to show people that you do have something to offer is a huge moment. There's so much to think about logistically, not only obviously designing the clothes and then getting the clothes to a level that you can show them on the catwalk, but if you want to show them, you have to find your venue, you have to find a slot when people are going to come, you have to find girls who are going to walk in the clothes, and then you have to get the people there and convince them that you're going to put these clothes in their stores or in their magazines and that they'll sell. It's a big deal.
The idea was actually to invite a small hand-picked group of fashion journalists and buyers, best in the world, and Victoria telling the tale of her garments. So it was a bit like an old couture presentation, you know? And Coco Chanel used to do it in her studio.
I felt really anxious, sick, nerves like I've never had nerves before. You know, I'd worked really hard on this collection. You know, I remember the night before, I was downstairs with a florist in a pair of hotel slippers at about 4 o'clock in the morning, redoing the flowers because I didn't like the way that the flowers looked.
It's really lovely.
I looked at the past, I looked at couture details, I looked at corsetry. It was all about dresses that were very fitted to the body. Lots of grosgrain used around the waist to really make the waist look tiny. Everything was corseted. The length was just below the knee. And I do continue to do those dresses in a similar shape.
We were just stunned, to be honest. It was just not at all what we were expecting. For a start, obviously, the main thing, the clothes were just really beautiful. They were some of the nicest clothes that we saw that week at New York Fashion Week. And it wasn't just my view that was, you know, what they said in the New York Times. It was really kind of really beautiful, beautiful dresses. And then the second thing that I think really surprised everyone was Victoria's involvement in the collection. We all sat down on these sofas in this very beautiful, elegant little room, and they had these dresses and on the rail, and then these girls walked in, and Victoria talked us through the details of every single dress and the construction. I remember her pointing out to us, there was one of the dresses had this grosgrain ribbon that you put in the waistband of a dress, and it's a kind of old Paris couture trick that stops a dress from riding up. It makes it settle on your waist. It's, you know, a proper dressmaking skill, and she knew all these things. She could talk
about all the dresses. She could answer every question, and we had loads of questions. And she was just incredibly impressive. I remember leaving and getting in the lift, and I was there with a couple of women from American Vogue. And as soon as the door closed, one of them just went, wow, I was not expecting that.
I remember that day like it was yesterday. After leaving Victoria and the hotel suite and seeing those gorgeous clothes, I called my buyer immediately and I said, do not walk, run to the show space and see these clothes. When I found out there was a limited number of dresses, I was practically on my hands and knees begging Victoria to ensure that I got the majority of the dresses for my customers. You know, it's an interesting role I have as fashion director. Not only do I lead my buying teams on the seasonal ideas that we at Neiman Marcus believe in, I spend a lot of time in my stores with the customers who shop with us. So I have a very intimate point of view about who our customers are and the kind of things they love. And I knew immediately what Victoria was doing is something that my customers would want to have in their wardrobe. And I also knew that Victoria's personal style, her personality, and her notoriety here in America was also going to be a great calling card for many of my customers, because the women who shop with us love her style and love how she looks and would absolutely be excited to see what she brings to fashion. So my buyer was there immediately, and much like myself, begging Victoria to make sure that we had as many dresses as possible. And I actually believe that we ended up getting the majority of what was produced above any other retailer, which I was quite happy
about. I came straight from interning to here. So for me, that whole set was quite unique anyway, because I'd only just finished university. And this, it was the first job that I'd ever really done. I was assisting her both on a personal level but also on a work level, and ended up doing things like, I remember all the stock came in for the first time, we had to ship it out of the office and things like that, and we were literally like packing boxes in a room that was no bigger than this one, and having to swing tag things by hand and like putting them on the head. So it was really, really hands-on, but it was for me about a bit of a baptism of fire, because I'd come from university and then into something that ended up being quite mainstream quite quickly. And so that was quite eye-opening for me. She introduced the idea of trying to use Skype to kind of keep in contact with each other, because obviously it's visual, and sometimes you can't always, and conference calls just sometimes feel so dry that you need to have that visual element to them to make sure that you're interacting with each other. And sometimes if she couldn't make it over twice in 1 month, she'd just come over once. That's how we kept in touch.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. There's a knock at my door. I wonder who it is for. So I peep and I see that it is you wanting me. Let's go away together. Find a place or go wherever. And when we land upon the moon, I say I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you. If you can find me, tell me how it would be. If you were with me, I bet you would surprise me. If you could find me, tell me how it would be. If you were with me, I bet you would surprise me. So let's go away together. Find a place or go wherever. And when we land upon the moon, I'll say I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you. If you find me, you can surprise.
Definitely an area that I want to move more into is being creative and having control and ownership, but taking a little bit of a back seat as well. You know, I don't feel the need for it to always be about me.
This is just that. So which take is this? Is this the follow-up?
I think it is really unexpected. People will be quite surprised by it. I think that you're only taking a risk if you're
not comfortable. For me, so long as I'm comfortable and I'm happy with something, I'm not taking a risk. But a lot of it is about personal taste, and you're never going to make everybody happy.
2, 1. Okay, well done.
This is season 2, second collection. A lot of hard work has gone into this. The turnaround has been really quick this season. I wanted to do short and long as well this season. We really created a signature silhouette last season. I wanted to expand on that. I wear short dresses, I wear long dresses, and I want to do everything.
We need to sit front on.
It was a challenge. I knew that I had a lot of people really wanting to see what I was going to do this season. There was an enormous amount of pressure. We have pushed ourselves.
You can put your hands down a little bit, that's it.
The colour stands out, and the fabric, the gold houndstooth boucle, really stands out because it's just such a great fabric. I think it's a real editorial piece. It's hard to pick a favourite because every dress I would wear myself.
Had a very clear idea in her head about what she wanted for the handbags. So we talked a lot about that, informally, formally, you know, on the telephone, by email. She sent me a huge pack of like tear sheets and sketches and ideas and things that, you know, like photographs of pieces of art and, you know, things that she'd just seen around, which I like that also. It's not, you know, some people don't really go to that extent of actually trying to visualise what they want. So we took that information and then tried to kind of like, I tried to get inside her head in terms of what the, you know, what the kind of DNA of the brand would be with visual references. And then we can, you know, like bit by bit we'd meet and we'd show Victoria's stuff and she'd react to it, and then, you know, we'd go away and work on it a little bit more, and then, you know, slowly we got the right thing.
I'm here in New York at Bergdorf Goodman to launch my denim and sunglasses collection.
Beyond the actual designing and presenting of the collections, each season sees a complex calendar of operations that come together to manufacture and distribute the clothes. Each season's fashion shows fall at a fixed time on the annual calendar, February to early March for autumn-winter shows, and September to early October for spring-summer shows. Give or take a few exceptions, the entire ready-to-wear industry adheres to it. Beyond the Fashion Week calendar, the design and manufacturing process works around the dates of the industry's leading fabric fair, Première Vision, which takes place in Paris each season. No matter what scale of brand, this is where many of the fabrics presented in future shows will be originally sourced. The production team takes over once Victoria and the design studio are satisfied with the one-off samples that have been developed by the in-house pattern cutters. The sales team set up showrooms in Paris, New York, London and Milan to present the new samples and gather orders from the store's buyers. Based on the feedback from the sales team, the production department start purchasing fabrics. Generally speaking, the production team has about 6 weeks to get fabric, from the day the order books close to the day the factory starts manufacturing. But this can extend up to 12 weeks for particularly rare or intricate fabrics. As soon as the fabrics arrive, Victoria's production team and factories have 6 weeks to cut and make the dresses. Detailed production packs are prepared so the factories can clearly understand how to make each piece. Once quality control checks have been completed, there's a week-long window for distribution before the 500 selling points, known as doors, across 60 different countries can offer the latest Victoria Beckham ready-to-wear collection to the world.
A lot of people would like to think that she just pops in from time to time and just sort of like has a look around and yes and no, but she's very not like that. I mean, sometimes as you know, as consultants on design, sometimes it's very easy, the project, if you are just left to your own devices and you create something and you come back and you're like, okay, this is what we think, and then you go away and you execute it. But it doesn't, it might be easier if it worked like that, but it really doesn't work like that. Victoria knows exactly what she wants, and what I help her to do is be able to realise it in leather and the techniques that we need to use to achieve the look and the feel that she wants. So it's kind of like, you know, it's very collaborative, and they wouldn't look like they did if she wasn't there with her eye and every tiny, you know, she's a perfectionist in terms of detail.
Your point of view, you know, you're putting your heart and soul into this, but you have to have a design team. I mean, especially, I don't know how you chose your team, but then, you know, they're in London here, aren't they? And you're half of the time in LA. How does it actually work?
Well, Roland Murray, who is actually managed by Simon Fuller as well, when I first started, he helped me put a very small team together that would help turn my dreams and my designs into reality. And as every working mum that's sitting out there, I'm sure, can relate to, I wake up every morning and I feel like I'm juggling glass balls. I live in Los Angeles. My business is run out of London, and most evenings I'm curled up in front of Skype in my dressing gown, speaking with my studio in London. I travel a lot. My team travel a lot. But I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm very proud to be British, and my brand is British, and I'm very proud of that. And it's hectic, but I love it. I just love what I do.
I had my interview with the headhunters, and they never tell you which company you're interviewing for. So I got to the interview, and they told me that it was a company that was based all on dresses and quite luxury, and I had absolutely no clue that it was going to be Victoria Beckham. I, in fact, thought it could have been Alice Temperley, because in London there aren't many companies that were specialised in dresses, and Alice Temperley was one. So I was totally unprepared for the brand name when it came out. So I was sitting in the interview, and then the headhunter said, well, actually it's for Victoria Beckham. And I had a moment. It was so unexpected, and I have to admit that, you know, like everybody else, coming from the fashion industry, we weren't really, she wasn't really on the radar yet. So I had a bit of a double take, and I was sitting in the interview thinking, goodness, I can't show my surprise too much. And what saved me was that just that month, Victoria had been on the cover of Vogue UK, and I had read the article, and it was actually, I think it was Alexander Shulman, the editor, who had interviewed Victoria, and she's quite a, you know, she's quite a tough lady to please. And so as I was preparing my reply, I was digging in the memory of this article which I had just read, and in a way, that in itself, the fact that Alexander Shulman had put her on the front cover, and not talk about her as a Spice Girl or anything to do with her past, but really to talk to her about to talk to her about being a designer, that had really been an endorsement. And it was very fresh in my mind. So I was able to quickly think, well, maybe I should rethink, maybe I should see the opportunity in this.
Wow, that was gorgeous. Like, great way to start a Sunday morning.
The evolution of Victoria Beckham is one of the ongoing pleasures of New York Fashion Week. The coherence and confidence of her latest collection show just how far she's come.
This season, I think what she was interested in is utility. You saw those, they almost look like car seat straps at the neck line of those halter dresses.
I love the element of very feminine sportswear. All those big parkas, you know, they're very luxurious. We really pushed ourselves with the fabrics this season, you know, with that double-faced satin, lots of couture elements in those big oversized coats. Last season we touched on movement away from the body and volume, and this season we've done that even more.
Every season you actually think she's reached a level, and I do think she's actually taking it on to something further, from the baseball caps to just utter, just sheer divine evening pieces. I love the interjection of the red, the sporty, the bondage, through to the print. Absolutely beautiful.
The thing that's always been amazing from Victoria from the very first collection is her tailoring. It was flawless tailoring, and the bags were so good.
She added squishiness to the bags. You know, her bags are so precise and very, very well constructed. And now she added that element of ease to them, and it's not quite so formal. It's more of an everyday bag.
There are real personal layers in these clothes.
Everything is very me. I'm very hands-on. Everything has my signature on it, and I would wear it.
She's very serious about this, but yet the clothes aren't so serious. That's what I love, is that the clothes have wit, they're modern. After only several seasons, she has her own signature, her clothes are recognizable, and that's a challenge of every young designer, and she's managed to do that.
I was in my convertible car because the house that rents in the south of France couldn't have internet easily. And I was like with my computer on my car, open, almost, you know, there was t-shirt, bathing suit, nude. I got an old English car. And in the middle of a vineyard, would I receive internet, and we're talking about the show every 2 days. On Skype or on just phone or other Viber, or it was very funny. Yes, I think this is Nothing can remplace, take the place of a human relation. Mostly, this kind of job is a lot about sensitivity. And so sometimes somebody in front of you can tell you yes, and the sound of this yes seems, I'm not sure. Through all this technology, you don't really feel that. But this technology helped to go, I won't say faster, I would say that can keep people in contact.
And for you, was it quite a step up, that show, most recent one? Did it feel like a substantial development from any other shows you've done?
For me it was, I hope for her it was too, and for her team. Team, there's something very, very specific about her and some other designers, but not all, which is a team word. She's difficult to grab because she's all around the world. I'm too. We are almost. Michelle is around the world, you know, like. But Frederic is here and there. But when we see, it's really like we have seen the day before. It's really a connected team. Do I think it's a step forward? Yes, I do. I do, because it's the first time that she also accepted to go forward.
How would you describe your collaboration, you know, in the build to a show? How often are you talking? How are you talking? You know?
Well, if we look to the next one, I've been able to speak with her. I've been able to speak with the group. But we cannot see each other because she wants everybody to be the stylist to her team around the table at the same moment to take decisions and to listen every point of view, which is a very good thing. So we blocked the space already, and I prepared 15 propositions of development based on what we done last season. And again, to try to go maybe 2 centimeters or even half an inch further and to arrive to a perfect image. This is what they have now. I'm supposed to see her early December. And she have in a box, we like a beautiful box, all the drawings, hand drawings, plans, renderings, computering, samples. So she can even herself look at home, exchange questions. And then when we'll see early December, we're gonna decide.
While one-to-one appointments and small presentations are relatively straightforward events to stage, a runway show requires many disparate elements to come together in a coherent manner. With an entire season's work channeled through an 8-minute show, it's essential that every last detail is both representative of the brand and precisely executed. Depending on the number of people expected to attend the show, as well as what the designer wants to convey, the choice of venue can differ dramatically. Each fashion capital has its mainstay venues, from intimate salons to huge cultural landmarks, yet brands have used everywhere from private apartments to train stations to medieval prisons in which to present their wares. Again, how a venue and runway space are configured and dressed can perfectly express brand values in the DNA of the collection. From austere minimalism to gilded Baroque decor, no two shows are the same. And as soon as one show ends, planning and development for next season begins. Shows are expected to attract the key players from the industry, and with this comes the highly sensitive matter of where to sit them all. In-house PR teams or outside agencies meticulously map out seating plans, send out invitations, and welcome guests to the venue and their seats. The front row, often identified as AA, followed by a number, is reserved for only the most powerful and/or high-profile individuals. No show takes place without models, and with models comes the need for casting agents, who both liaise with international model agencies or engage in street castings. A week of fine-tuning the collection takes place with the designer, the stylist consultant, the show producer, and the development team, all working in close collaboration. Following the casting, design samples will be fitted to models, shoes will be allocated, and the rotation of the looks and pacing of the show will be determined. Once the models arrive at the venue, they undergo lengthy hair and makeup transformations at the hands of a high-profile hairstylist and makeup artist, accompanied by big teams of assistants. What happens backstage at a show is just as important as what's presented front of house. As well as pure production teams hired to make sure things run smoothly and on time, backstage production will also entail a lighting expert and DJ or musical supervisor to enhance the overall sensory experience of the show.
The British Fashion Award for Designer Brand of the Year goes to Victoria Beckham.
My team. You all know who you are for everything that you do. Thank you. Your focus, your creativity. Thank you. I couldn't do it without you. Simon Fuller, very dear friend and the best business partner that anybody could possibly ask for. Thank you. This is such a big deal for me, it really is, and I can't thank my team enough. Without them, I wouldn't be in this position, and my husband and my kids. I always dreamed this would happen one day, but it really is a dream come true.
I always wanted to work in fashion, and when I was given the opportunity, I took that opportunity with both hands. I want to empower women. I want to make women feel good about themselves. And for me to be able to achieve the quality that I want to give my customer, I have to do that in London. My brand is British. My team are all British. You can feel the energy as you're driving through London. I mean, I remember when I was younger, I used to love going to Camden Market, you know, on a Sunday. I mean, the energy, the atmosphere, it's really multicultural. That is more inspiring than anything. You know, in Britain, we don't feel the need to conform. We dance to the beat of our own drum. We're individual, we're passionate, we're very, very creative. Anna Wintour is British. She is the editor-in-chief of American Vogue. She's probably the most respected person in the fashion industry ever. The Queen is, I mean, she's an icon. She's so appropriate, very, very chic. I mean, she's the Queen. In Britain, we have some incredible brands. When you look at Burberry, Stella McCartney, Alexander McQueen, Macintosh, Hunter, we have really cool, quality British brands. And I'm really proud to consider myself one of those. Music has always influenced everything that I do. I love music. David loves music, but he can't dance. I mean, when you look at the talent in Britain over the years, Stone Roses, Oasis, The Beatles, The Spice Girls, you know, Adele, I mean, we really have a lot of talent. And British music, again, like fashion, is very, very cool and very, very relevant. I'm very, very proud to be British, and I love living in America. I embrace living in America. But I am British, David is British, the kids are British, and we're very, very proud of that. I like to do lots of in-store events where I'm really getting to know my retailer and also know my customer and what she wants around the whole world. So I've been to Asia, I've been to Canada, obviously spent a lot of time in America, I've been to Russia, I've been to lots of different parts of Europe. So I can get influenced from lots of places. I mean, I love going to Asia. Asia is a very important market and my brand is very international. What do people expect of me? I think people expect the best.
I think the company is moving very quickly, and certain things like e-com, everyone was very skeptical about Victoria launching e-com, for instance, before her own retail. That's the other way around from the way most brands will do it. They'll have a really solid retail network and then they'll add on the e-com, whereas she chose to do it the other way around because she felt that e-com was actually a faster way, quicker, and where she could actually represent her brand through all the imagery that she's very keen on.
The most recent example, probably because it feels so fresh in the mind, is the introduction of, you know, an additional collection within the season, as we call it, pre-collection. And if you think about it, you know, before we were doing two collections a year, so essentially, you know, if you divide the year into you know, two chunks of 6 months, you're delivering product effectively only into the store only for half the year. So you're leaving the store empty of your product for the other half of the year. And it became very clear to me, you know, when every time I visited one of our markets, I'd walk into one of the department stores or specialty stores that stocked us, you know, sometimes, depending on the time, I'd walk in and there'd be none of our product because we've always had very high sell-through, so the product lands and goes and is sold very quickly.
Kategorie Fashion geht an Victoria Beckham.
I think she's managed over the period of time between the first time she was on the cover of British Vogue and now to completely change people's perception of her.
I admire her kind of sense of adventure and that she can do that.
Most of the people never were successful in a second or third career. She is an exception.
Thank you very much.
In every sense of the word, as a personality and everything.
She is.
First and foremost, I'm a mum and a wife, but I'm in the studio every day. It's quite a lot. It's quite intense. There's a lot that goes on behind the scenes that people don't realise. It's not just coming to work and design a dress. This is what I want to wear. You know, pricing, selecting fabrics. This is our office. Over here we have the Victoria line. So this is VVB. Okay. Feel free to wear it, guys. Over here is ready to wear. So again, like I said, a lot of people aren't actually here at the moment. But Louis's here, so it's totally fine. And we have windows, which is nice, because up until a few weeks ago, we didn't have any windows. And so it was always quite difficult. I literally used to go out onto the balcony with fabric to have a look at the colours. I have a great team of people, quite a small team of people, that have come on this journey so far with me and will continue to go even further.
Speaks to how ready to wear we'll do when we
get our models and your models in there, do you think?
Well, this is the thing, so we're looking how to partition the space.
I really feel that we have established now something that, you know, has some scale. I mean, you know, if you compare us to big brands, we're still small, but we're not, you know, the kind of startup that we were 5 years ago.
So there's a lot that goes on, even after the show. You know, that's not where the hard work finishes. We hand the collection over to the sales team go and sell it, but then there's still a lot of work that has to go on here. Leon, where did Leon get that picture from? Hi, Saskia.
Hi.
And are people mainly picking either the blue or the pink, and then the neutrals, or are they going for both?
Our challenge right now is to create the new and innovative way to perhaps invigorate the line, really, that it's appropriate for the show.
She's very keen to receive sales feedback. She wants to know what the buyers are responding to because she needs to know that information to design her next collection, which is what she gets down to right after the show.
So this dress, for example, is an icon dress. It's a dress from a past collection, one of my favourites. Has the signature zip. And so that will be sold exclusively online.
I would say it's quite typical of her that she sets the benchmark very high.
I want this business to still be here in 20, 30, 40, 50 years' time. It's about attention to detail and just making sure that everything's done right.
Branded Victoria Beckham box. It is quite rewarding to know that you've kind of taken the care over it. Hope when it gets to the other end that someone appreciates the effort that's gone in.
We always do like a presentation of the latest collection, so this is the first time we've shown Prig, so it's just a chance for all the customers to see all the collections together in one space.
And I get very excited if I see someone walking down the street. The fact that they have chosen to wear one of my dresses or something from my collection, that's very, very exciting.
The very first time that I saw a Victoria Beckham dress was back in 2008. And since that time, I have managed something. I wear Victoria Beckham dress.
I want to be proud of everything that I do. I don't want to compromise. I want to have products that I'm proud of, a business that I'm proud of, and a business that is up there with the most successful luxury brands that there are. and one that's really relevant fashion wise as well. I don't want to compromise. Thank you so much.
Bye.
See you later. Bye.
Bloop, bloop.